welcome to the second part of the introductory on the energy transition. And we will come to the first pillar of the energy transition, and that will be energy storage. And quite often we hear energy storage is a new topic in energy supply, but it isn't. Energy storage always had been the basis for every energy supply system. When we go back a few thousand of years, then it was biomass, it was bioenergy, and bioenergy is a power source, it's an energy source, and in the same way it's also the storage that it has incorporated in the biomass. Nature found a process to convert CO2 with the help of sunlight and with the help of water to produce biomass and evaporating oxygen. That nature is doing with a light reaction and a dark reaction, more you find in the script on how that works. What we could complain nature is maybe the process is not very efficient. So when we start with a 100% energy from solar radiation, then we lose by optical losses a part of the energy. We lose through the orientation of the leaves. We lose for the light reaction, for the dark reaction losses and the own consumption of the plants. And then maybe the overall efficiency of plants of to produce biomass is just a maximum of 2.5%. But more commonly it's even less than 1%. But energy storage is always has been the basis for an energy system. And even when we go back a thousand years, then maybe we started to use wind energy, solar energy, hydropower, but maybe not for producing electricity, but as a source to help people to make daily life more easy. And then it follows what we know today as the fossil fuel age. And that was a big increase in consumption. And what is fossil fuel? Mainly fossil fuel again is solar energy. Again, it is a stored form of solar energy. Only that to produce these fossil fuels, it required thousands, millions of years when the oil, the gas, the lignite, the hard coal resources had been produced by old biomass and old fossils. And now what we are going back, when we get rid of these fossil ages, we return again to wind energy, solar energy, hydro energy, energy from biomass. And then again we talk about storage, but maybe nowadays we talk about different kind of storage. But when we look to all the ages, energy storage was always needed. It is impossible having a power system, an energy system, that does not have a storage component incorporated. And quite often that is neglected when we discuss that today, these arguments, oh, when we need energy storage and everything becomes so expensive, that we should not go for renewables. And then I always compare their opinion. Do you think our energy system, it is just a bone? So having on the one side just generation, then we have only the transmission and distribution lines, and then the consumption side where we directly consume when we produce. But that is only a part of our energy system. And taking as an example, okay, we have the hydro storage, pumped hydro storage, but it's the only we think that we have on storage. But it's not true, because the energy system maybe starts somewhere in Australia where the hard coal is produced. It is stored on a coal dump, it is stored in large ships going half the globe and coming maybe to Rotterdam, then it is stored in smaller ships when it goes down or upwards the Rhine River, where it is stored again on a coal dump close to the hard coal power station. And then somewhat much later, with many losses incorporated in that chain, we produce electricity just in time when we need. The same with natural gas. Natural gas is not produced next to the natural gas power station. Maybe it is produced somewhere in Russia. Then it is desulfurized, the CO2 is separated. Then it is stored and transported in large pipelines, or liquefied and stored in ships. And then it is stored in our salt caverns that we have in northern Germany, for example. And much, much later, we produce electricity just when we need. But before that, we have a large chain of energy storage process. It's the same when we talk about oil. Maybe it's produced somewhere in the Arabian world. And then we ship it either via pipelines or via large ships to our country, where we store it in large tanks, in refineries, and then maybe large later, we convert the oil into power or use it for driving our cars or whatever. When we come to nuclear power stations, it's even more difficult. The chain is much longer. We have the uranium ore that is maybe produced somewhere in Canada. Then we need to separate the stones from the uranium. We need to separate uranium-238 from the 235. Only the 235 we can use in our nuclear power stations. Then we produce fuel elements, and then we store them. And much later we produce electricity when we need. And with nuclear we have another storage process. Even after we have produced electricity, we need to store the waste over many, many thousand years. What you see here is the picture from the carnival here in Cologne, where they make some jokes about the Asse, and they say, oh, I've got incontinence, and that with a half-life of 24,000 years. So there is again large storage implemented. And therefore I always say our energy system also today is not a bone. It's more a knuckle of pork, but the meat is on the left side of the system. And meat is nothing else than stored energy. And on the right side, there we just have the bone. What else do we have? Of course, we can store electricity. We have our pumped hydro power sources. Or we have compressed air energy storage. We have a large variety of battery technologies. We can produce hydrogen and store the hydrogen and later maybe produce electricity back again. Or we can store mechanical energy in the form of wheels, for example. Or directly can store electric power or electric energy in capacitors or superconducting coils. And here, Sama writes, when we go for that technology, storing electricity, maybe it is then becoming quite expensive and also maybe inefficient. But there is another possibility we could do, and that is we could just turn the knuckle of pork to the other side. And in that logic, nowadays we store energy before we produce electricity, it would mean we store energy after we have already used electricity. And that seems a bit nonsense. How can you store something that you already have used? But to be honest, who really wants to have electricity? Did you ever touch electricity? Electricity is nothing nice. When you touch it, it hurts. So we don't really like electricity. But what we like is what we produce out of electricity. And that what we produce out of electricity, that we again maybe quite easily can store. And that is not a new idea, that is exactly that system for night storage heating, where we use electricity when it's there but nobody wants to consume it. We heat up those bricks to produce high temperature, put heat insulation around, and then we discharge the heat, not producing back to electricity when we require the heat. So it's a very cheap form. Those heating systems are not very popular, but it's a cheap form of energy storage. And in the same way of thinking, we have many processes we can use to adapt electricity consumption and electricity generation. So what are we using electricity for? We produce a lot of cold by electricity, a lot of heat applications. Or when we look to our heating systems, our hot water heating systems, we use electricity to transport the hot water in buildings. It's a large amount of system. Or our heating, ventilation, air conditioning systems are driven by electric power. And here we can shift power consumption in time. Or compressed air, we don't need to produce compressed air storage power stations, because there we have a lot of losses when you go back to electricity. But compressed air is a heat, is an energy source in industry, and when we store compressed air and use compressed air later, again, it's a storage process after electricity has been used. And finally, we can operate our CHP units, maybe driven by bioenergy or nowadays still by natural gas. And then we decouple power and heat production by means of a heat storage and not electrical storage. We will learn later in the course why heat storage is so much more interesting and viable than electricity storage. And the other way around, the same thinking, we could use heat pumps and produce heat, for example, when we have too much wind or sun, and store then the heat and use the heat when we have the requirement to heat our houses. So a lot of possibilities to store without using maybe very expensive electrical storage technologies. And here it shows what is the today picture. When we just look for the discharge capacity, our pumped hydro storage have just a power of a bit more than 5 gigawatt. What we have installed in storage systems, in heating storage systems, it is almost 40 gigawatt, and it's almost a factor of 8. But when we look more, a bit more detail, then we see what we can do by heat storage in our houses, operating our heat pumps, for example, and doing maybe some load shifting. That is quite good from 1 hour to the other. It also works with some processes from one day to the other. But then we might see, yes, we also have a requirement to store energy maybe over a week or even over a month, not very often, but sometimes. And then many technologies like the demand response, like plug-in hybrid or pure electric vehicles, pumped hydro storage, compressed air energy storage does not work anymore. So let's go back to our energy system, how we have dismantled it to become 100% renewable. We need, of course, incorporate electric cars when we don't have fossil fuels anymore. And they have a storage capacity, can be used to control our overall energy system. And again, here we see a step towards energy efficiency. Because when we compare the efficiency from a fuel-driven car, that is more heat production than really driving force, it's much more efficient going to the electric motor. And again, without using less mobility, we have a big step in energy efficiency. Then when we look at our heat pumps that we have in the buildings now, when we attach here a hot water tank, a heat energy storage device, then we can use always the electricity when it is produced to produce heat and store the heat and use it later when maybe there is no electricity from sun and wind, but we have a requirement to heat our houses. The same when we produce cold in refrigerators, for example, we can use the cold when it's there from wind and sun and store the cold. We can also, in a certain time range, control our hot water heating system. Again, a quite big influence on electricity consumption by all the pumps we need to circulate the hot water. And also we could discuss about operating our washing machines, our dishwashers or dryers when there is a lot of electricity available, But that is the only components, the three components, that do not have really a storage process incorporated, and therefore it's a bit tricky whether people will accept that or not, because here more the patience of the people is the storage. But in all other what we discussed just, their storage is incorporated, and it's not a difference in the habits of the people living in those houses. But who tells the heat pump, the refrigerator, and all the other devices when they should consume electricity and not? And that is what we need a so-called smart grid for. What is a smart grid? I think they are much more complex and maybe even better explanation. But a very simple one is, it's not really something new, but we need again to combine already existing things. We all know the information grid, the internet is there since many years. Electrical grid is there, and we need to pay for electricity, so we have the energy meter. And when we now combine electricity system with the internet and with the smart meter, then we could say that is something what we can call a smart grid. And when we have that infrastructure, then brings communication infrastructure to every household, at least to where the electricity meter is. The picture shows, I don't want to discuss it in detail, but it's not only the electricity meter that can be used, it's all the other sectors too. It shows the ways of communication, either power line communication or via mobile communication, and how data is then aggregated in order to provide new services also to the customer. For example, like in that display we see here at the right lower part of the slide, electricity prices that may differ in every hour or even in every 15 minutes, and then the users might be able to adopt behavior on that and act like an energy storage. And when we then also add the smart metering service with the in-house communication, then we have an automated demand-side management. And that does not only for the private homes, that also works, for example, in production units. Here we see some photos in the injection molding machines of a company close to Cologne that can be adopted also to the electricity supplies. But then when we come to the long-term storage, at the moment, how can we do that? It is either by hydrogen or by renewable methane. We will discuss that later. But it is mainly due to the high energy densities. That is more or less at the moment, we don't see alternatives for hydrogen and renewable methane. We have some very large heat storages that also can do a seasonal storage. But for electricity, maybe these two are the only ones. And when we come back to our energy system, then we see we can produce hydrogen by electrolysis, where we connect the electrical grid. But then we have the hydrogen, and what to do then with the hydrogen? We don't have an infrastructure for hydrogen. But you remember, I already dismantled something, but we still have it there, it's our natural gas infrastructure. And maybe I delete here the import part, then we still have the infrastructure. And when we add to the hydrogen carbon dioxide, then we have this very old, very long time known Sabatier reaction, where hydrogen with CO2 and the catalyzer reacts to CH4 to methane and water. And that means with this technology we can connect the green and the yellow system here, the electrical with the natural gas infrastructure. And what is even better, then we could use this enormous storage infrastructure we already have for natural gas. And that could solve in future a big part of our energy storage challenge. It's not only fantastic, here for example we see a quite complex graph, but at least nowadays it's a quite inefficient way to store energy. It has so many advantages, but the efficiency going from electricity to methane, store it, and back to electricity back again has enormous losses. But there are also some solutions that might make that more efficient. So ways to achieve 100% renewable electricity supply, that triangle for our pillar number one, is definitely energy storage. Theoretically, we could say we solve everything by energy storage. That means we have the renewable production according to what we consume, and the balancing according to time and place is completely done by energy storage. For sure, that will not be an economic efficient solution. To store every kilowatt hour produced somewhere in the energy storage device and produce electricity back again. But a theoretical solution it would be. So the first pillar definitely is storage. And now we will continue then the next video, part 3 of the presentation of the first lecture, with electricity over production. Thank you very much.